Hello, chemistry students. I hope you're not tired of hearing my voice every morning as we talk about various essential nonmetals out there. Today, we have the topic of oxygen in section 10.2. I hope that you guys find these somewhat interesting. We're actually going to have a lab. That's kind of cool. And we're going to do that starting next week. And I'm going to attempt to separate. I say attempt because you know how things work, but attempt to separate oxygen, hydrogen, maybe light some oxygen on fire or hydrogen. We'll see. So I'm gonna find out. So anyways, let's start taking these notes. Oxygen, the occurrence, it is the most abundant element in the Earth's crust, accounting for about 50% of the mass of the crust in the Earth. That's a lot. That's a whole lot. The oxygen we breathe in is in the form of O2, makes about 21% of the air we breathe in. If it was lower, we would asphyxiate, meaning we wouldn't be able to breathe. And if it was higher, if we lit a fire, we couldn't stop it. We already have trouble stopping fire, right? Take a look at Australia. But anyway, oxygen exists as two allotropes. And don't get confused over the word allotrope. It simply means a form where it's all by itself. And so naturally occurring, it exists as O2 and O3. Oxygen, classically known, and ozone. Well, what's the difference? We'll talk about that in a slide or two. Oxygen's properties. Oxygen is also an odorless, tasteless, and colorless solid or gas. Whew, not a solid, hopefully not. Except we can, when it gets very, very, very cold, make it a liquid and a solid. It becomes a bright blue color. That's pretty cool. Oxygen is most essential to the human body. Ozone, O3, is actually toxic and very odorous. It smells bad. But it does play a very essential role in protecting us from the sun's harmful rays. And a lot of people think that the ozone hole is being created over the South Pole, and that we have done that ourselves. And that's kind of tough to say. A lot of people think that we are putting freon, which is an air conditioning part, and it contains fluorine. And what it does is, when fluorine gets into the atmosphere, it actually splits apart O3 and makes it oxygen. So it's creating this massive hole. And we've seen this this blue spot created. And unfortunately, the side effect of having an ozone hole is increased risk of skin cancers and eye damage from UV rays. Fortunately, right now, this hole, so to speak, is only pretty big over Antarctica and Corona. Watch out. But that it's growing, and there is concerns of that. But the recent studies that I've done actually say that it's actually not growing at all, and that we're it's self-repairing itself from whatever damage we could have done. But ozone is pretty important regardless. Preparing oxygen, little needs to be done to prepare oxygen because it's just naturally there through an air filter. So you can just filter it out. Oxygen is naturally replenished by photosynthesis through the chemical formula. 6 CO2 plus 6 water. I missed the 6. Becomes glucose, C6H12O6, and 6 oxygen. So plants naturally take carbon dioxide and water and make it into sunlight, or make it into glucose and energy, an energy formula, and oxygen. Passing voltage near O2 can make it become ozone. So I guess we could, artificially tamper with the ozone layer, but the reaction will not take place without the spark due to its high enthalpy. So you take a look at the enthalpy, or kind of free energy, usable energy. It's this massive amount, 284.5 kilojoules. And so without a spark of energy, it doesn't really happen. If you've ever been outside after a thunderstorm and lightning struck nearby, or you ever been near a electric train or a high voltage source, especially when it's wet, there is a kind of a strong, sharp odor that smells a little bit less like being wet and more like just nasty. Strong. That's actually ozone. So you wouldn't want to go up into the atmosphere and breathe it in. It's kind of not so fun to breathe in. Reactions. Oxygen is moderately reactive, forming compounds with every element except for the noble gases. Nothing bonds with the noble gases. So, anyway. Most reactions require oxygen to be in the presence of heat, unless it is in the presence of an alkali or alkaline metal to which it joins readily. So consider if you have pure lithium, it will react with oxygen naturally, or pure sodium. So actually, if you take sodium, like Na, not the ion sodium, just regular old sodium, it will react with the air. You can just take it out of a jar, and it just starts reacting and combusting. Because of the strength of the alkali metal. Most other reactions require heat or some sort of spark or something take place. Combustion is a very familiar reaction involving oxygen. All hydrocarbons burn in atmospheric O2, produce CO2 and water. So here's an example, and that is with fireplace. Fire or wood is actually a whole bunch of carbon and hydrogen, among other things, but when lit, it from this hydrocarbon and from this oxygen produces carbon dioxide and water. Now, of course, my first reaction to this was, can't produce water. Water would put out the fire, but it's actually almost like a steam. So it is vapor water and vapor carbon dioxide, which of course is not very breathable and does pollute things mildly, so we do have to be careful of that. Uses of oxygen. The most obvious use is for breathing, and oxygen is condensed, used for breathing apparatuses, torches, liquid fuel rockets. Oxygen is consumed for human metabolism, up to 500 liters of oxygen per day. But fortunately, there's lots and lots of plants and lots of algae that restore the amount of usable oxygen in the atmosphere very quickly, so you don't have to worry about breathing and wasting stuff on the planet. Hydrogen peroxide is another very useful form of oxygen, H2O2, pure form of hydrogen oxygen. It's a colorless liquid, and it's useful as an antiseptic and bleaching agent. If you ever go into a doctor's office and it just smells clean, it's because they use hydrogen peroxide. See, bleach has a very unique smell. It smells like bleach. Hydrogen peroxide just smells like a doctor's office. Just clean, yet unique. That's hydrogen peroxide. And you can also use that if you'd like to pour it all in your hair. It'll turn your hair like blonde. So, now, that's not giving you permission, though. It's just saying that it'll turn your hair blonde. And you want to use 3% hydrogen peroxide for that, not like 6 or 100%. If you pour 100% hydrogen peroxide, you're not going to have hair. So 3% is a great concentration. 1% is even better. Anyway, when applied to a substance, H2O2 breaks down into water and oxygen. And during the reaction, oxygen is left to find another oxygen, creating what's called a free radical. It's also called a harmful free radical by some. And what the harmful free radical does is it, when finding another oxygen, it starts to rip things away from other things. So here's a free radical, right? 7 valence electrons. That's a problem. Everything wants 8. And so this is a healthy, stable atom. This is like a sad atom here, and it's just going to rip things to shreds. And so what it does is it finds bacteria that are like crawling around the surfaces of stuff. And if you pour hydrogen peroxide on it, it's just going to rip that bacteria to shreds as it breaks down into oxygen and water. And of course, the byproduct, water and oxygen, are both very harmless stuff, and so it's pretty harmless of a substance. That's why it bleaches stuff. It actually rips the electrons out of your hair. So that's kind of interesting. And that's it. So anyway, make sure you do section review 10.2, page 156. Signing off for today. I will see you guys later.